All right, good morning. Let's all sing this morning. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. Let's sing.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me. A sinner condemned, unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden he prayed, not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own grief, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burdens in Calvary and suffered and died alone. When with the ransom and glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Welcome to Oasis Baptist Church Online. My name is Rachel, and I'll be your service host. We just want to thank you for joining us right where you are. Our mission here at Oasis is to lead others to be passionate followers of Christ. So we invite you and your family to join us as we worship today. In Psalms 95, verses 1 and 2, it says, "O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise unto the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms." So I pray that wherever you are joining us from, that you will sing, give thanks, and make a joyful noise unto the rock of our salvation.
These are the days of Elijah.
Days of retreat.
Oh.
Series Yes You Can, where we will be experiencing the access to the Father because Jesus Christ rose again. But before we do, if you are new to Oasis, we would love to connect with you. So wherever you are watching us from, there is a link provided that will take you to a connect form. Will you please take a moment and fill out that form for us? We would love to reach out to you and your family. At Oasis, we are so thankful for the opportunity of an online church. And we know that God is going to continue to do an amazing thing through Oasis Online, and we want you to be a part of it. Will you share and invite your friends and families to oasislv.church and not waste this opportunity? Right now, please join Pastor Aaron as he brings his message, Yes, You Can, because you've been given access.
Welcome this morning to Oasis Baptist Church. I am excited to continue our series here in Yes, You Can. A question is often stated, or should I say a statement is often used, is this: it's not what you know, but it's who you know. It's not what you know, but it's who you know, which is often related to a word that we're going to talk a lot about right now this morning, is this, the word access. What does it mean to have access to something or someone? What would it mean if you had direct access to the owner of, I don't know, say a favorite company that you might invest in or you enjoy, or a product that you have, or maybe it's a football or a baseball or a sports franchise that you have direct access to those, the owners, or maybe it's your favorite musician or actor, actress, maybe it's a president, maybe it's a somebody else, but what if you had direct access to them? The word access means this. It is the ability or clearance to do something. The ability or clearance to do something. So I would say then with that is that having access is incredibly important, and it could be even powerful. To know that your access, the people or the things that you have ability to, or the clearance to get into, knowing where and what you can do gives us great power, or it gives us great opportunity. See, if you have access to a business owner that can give you the job of your dreams, that means a lot to you. If you have access to somebody that can repair your car or fix some repairs around the house, and you don't have to go outside to somebody that you don't know, it saves you a lot of money, or it saves you a lot of time. And there's a lot of things that we can look at with what it is when we have access. Today we continue our series, Yes You Can, and we're going to jump into the book of Ephesians, where we come to Paul is really beginning a prayer. He's in the study notes, it kept saying that in the parentheses of the prayer, he begins to speak and he begins to share his heart, emphasizing to the Ephesians and to the others that would read this, and giving them the truth or the understanding of the resources that are directly in front of them because they have been given the gospel, because the mysteries of the gospel have been given to them and it's beginning to open their eyes. Paul was sharing how he was sent to teach and to share of this mystery and to show them, again, the access that they had to Christ. Or maybe to share with them the availability and what is available in knowing who Jesus Christ is as Savior. Paul starts in chapter 3 really by reminding them of his personal call. A call for this cause in chapter 3 and verse 1. I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ. He shares with them that he is a prisoner of Jesus Christ to then share the truth that has been entrusted to him. He says, I've been called. In verse 2, it says, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, if you have heard of the stewardship, is really what this says, which is given to me to you. See, Paul was sharing with them that he had been called to be a steward, it says there, of the grace of God. A steward is this. A steward was somebody who is responsible for taking care of that which belonged to somebody else. A steward supervised things. Maybe it was like things of where and how the harvesting, the planting would take place. They would steward the meal preparations, and they would steward the things around the house. They would steward things that were not their own. Paul says, he was called to be a steward of the grace of God. He says in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12 and 13, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer and a prosecutor and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. He says, God chose me, but not only that, he did so, it was by the grace of God that God chose him. It was by the grace of God. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 7, it says he was made a minister. God appointed him. God called him and appointed him a ministry. In verse 14 of 1 Timothy chapter 1, he says, "And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus." See, I believe Paul was passionate about sharing this hope because Paul grasped something. One, Paul grasped the access that he had to Jesus Christ, but also Paul grasped this. And he said that he was appointed a steward by God's grace. He was appointed a steward by God's grace. That is, the grace of God reached down, tugged upon Paul's heart, drew him to himself. But then it says this, that he was appointed by God's grace, then became a steward of God's grace. He realized that he was entrusted. Something was given to Paul that he couldn't keep in himself, and it had to go somewhere else. And so Paul right here in this passage in Ephesians is sharing with the Ephesians. He was sharing with the Jew and the Gentile alike that they were called to be together, that they had access, that there was something that was given to them, that they had direct access, this revelation that they could go to God directly through. And so Paul shared with them that he is a steward of this grace and that he is to share this mystery that was revealed to him and that this same grace is available to them. He says the same access that I have is available directly to you. This morning as Paul was sharing and Paul prayed for the church then, I too would pray that we would see what has been revealed to us. That we would see what has been revealed, what has been given to us, the access that we have. We would see this access that is offered because of his amazing grace, because of his amazing love. See, we have been given a responsibility. If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior this morning, there's a responsibility that's been given to you. Your eyes have been opened. The mystery of God's Word, the mystery of the gospel has opened your mind so that you see it. You saw your sinfulness and you begged God for that salvation. And in that, you now have been entrusted with the gospel. You have been given a responsibility to now go and entrust that to somebody else, to share the access that you have and give that to them. And that's what Paul is doing, and that's what Paul's praying for, that they would understand it, that they would see that responsibility, that we would understand the Word of God says that my life is no longer my own, rather I have been bought with a price. I have been given this access, and with it comes a responsibility to be the steward of his grace and love. I have been entrusted. And today I share with you, as Paul shared, that because of our access through the blood of Jesus Christ, you and I can be bold. You and I are granted the riches according to his glory, the Word of God says. And all of this happens as we are filled with the fullness of God. This morning, my prayer is that we grasp a hold of the access that we have to the Lord and the joy and the fullness that it gives because he did, because he sent his son, died upon a cross, and rose again. Yes, you can, because you have been given access. Why? Because Jesus Christ rose from the dead to give you a newness of life. This morning, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter number 3. We're going to start in verse number 8, and I pray that this morning's message will be an encouragement to you. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 8. "Unto me, who am less than the least of all the saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who recreated all things by Christ, Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in the heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him Wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Father, I come to you right now and I just ask that, God, you would use this sermon, that you would use your word to just tug on the hearts of those that would hear it. And God, I believe as believers, so many times we fail to realize the access that we have to you. And I also feel that there's many who do not know you as Savior, that do not understand that they too can have access to you. Maybe they believe that they're just too far gone, that they can't do anything to gain that access, to which I would say I pray even now that they would understand that and see and realize that, God, you died for all. And God, would you just tug upon their heart? God, be with us now. I pray that you would speak to each one that listens and that you would draw them closer to yourself. For it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. You have been given access. I'm going to jump in here to Ephesians chapter 3, and I'm going to take a large chunk of scripture. We're not going to go verse by verse through this, but I'm going to take several thoughts, and I'm going to point it to that you and I have been given access. And inside of that access, this first thought is this: access gives us boldness. You have been given access, and that access gives us boldness. I would ask this question, or a couple questions here this morning. Who deserves to have access? Who deserves to have access? Or this: why would I give you access? You might say, well, access to what? I mean, if we just looked at it in just a broad scope, how many people would you just say, hey, here's the keys to my house, I'm going to give you access to my home? Or for me, maybe here's the keys to the church, or here's the keys to my office, or here's the keys to the safe, or whatever that is. Who deserves to have that access? Why would you give somebody access? There's a reason that to do certain things, there's a clearance and background checks and all of those things. But, you know, we come to this passage of scripture, and I would bet that not many people in those days, long before this, would have given access to much, especially inside of the church, to Paul. Paul was not one of those guys that was just a phenomenal guy. Many of you know the story. Saul, who became Paul on the Damascus Road, Saul was killing Christians. Saul was persecuting and putting him in jail and doing all of these things. And so not many people would have given him access. However, he says this in chapter number 3 and verse 8, unto me who am less than the least of all the saints is this grace given. See, when we look at this thought of having been given access, and that access gives us boldness, I think if there was something that Paul always remembered, he always remembered who he was. I don't know that Paul used it as a crutch to say, oh, well, I can't do this because of all of the things that I once did. But Paul never forgot who he was. I think it's several times throughout the scriptures, throughout his epistles, that he makes reference to him being the least of all of the saints, or the chiefest of sinners. But at the same time, he never forgets the grace of God that brought him as he was walking down that Damascus road, that light struck him as he fell, as Saul looked up and said, whoa, what's going on? What do you want from me? What do I need to do? He never forgot who he was. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 10, it says this way. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. Paul was called out. He took it serious, the calling that he had, and he never forgot the grace of God. That God would use him. And so as we get into this, we begin to look at the seriousness of what was taking place in chapter 3 and why Paul was so just begging and pleading with those there, the Ephesian church, but also as he's praying before God, God, would you show them this? Would they see all of these things? Would they understand that which is given to them? Would they understand why I do what I do, why I come so boldly before them? He came boldly before them because he was so confident in who God was, because of all that God had done and the grace that God had given him. He took advantage of the access that God gave, and he shared, the Word of God says that he shared the unsearchable riches of God to them. He shared the unsearchable riches of Christ to the Gentiles, giving the mystery to make all men see, is what it says, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God. He says in verse 9 that he was giving them, his call was to take the mystery and to give it to them that they might see. Now, obviously, we understand that Paul could not open their eyes, but as the preacher and the teacher of the Word of God, he gave it to them, and the Holy Spirit would open their eyes that they could see. He goes on to say, it's the eternal purpose in Christ Jesus our Lord, whom we have boldness, access with confidence by faith for all eternity. This was the plan, that we would have access to the Father. This was God's eternal plan. It was never God's intention that we would be separated from him. God's intention in the garden was what? That they were one with God. They walked with him, but in sin, there was separation. And nearly immediately, God then made a way that they could come back to him, because it was always the intention. It was always the purpose that we would have access to the Father through Jesus Christ. Today, it's in Christ Jesus that we have access. I don't know about you, but I feel sometimes I miss this more than I should in my walk with God. I miss the reality and being bold and confident going before the throne of God. Because sometimes I fail to realize who God is. Sometimes I get to the place where everything's okay in my life and I'm doing such a good job, and I fail to realize the grace that God has given to me, the mercy and the love that God has given to me. Today, I come to you and I say, in Christ Jesus, we have access. In Christ Jesus, whom we should be having a boldness to go to God, in whom we have boldness with confidence by the faith of him. Wherefore I desire, what does he say, that we would not faint? Listen, God's desire is that we would go boldly to the throne. The desire is that we would go to Jesus, who is sitting upon the right hand of God and interceding on our behalf. Today, I ask you, are you going boldly before the throne of God? Are you going boldly before your Father? Maybe this is a silly illustration, but maybe this would touch base and hit home a little bit. See, if I were to go to my house right now, leave here, drive home, and pull into one of my neighbor's home, and just open the door and walk directly to their kitchen and go into the refrigerator and grab out a drink or get some water and go sit on the couch and take the remote from whomever is there and change the channel, one, I'm probably not going to be greeted with a very friendly smile. But we just don't do that. Because I have not been given access to their home, access to their refrigerator, access to anything in that personal of a manner. However, if I were to go to my parents' home right now, walk into their home, I could freely go into the kitchen. I could freely go into a cabinet or a cupboard and grab a snack. I could go in, and 9 out of 10 times, my mom's going to say, you can change that, because she realizes that I probably don't want to watch the Hallmark Channel. But I have access to go into my parents' home because of the relationship, and because of I've been given that access. See, God has given me that access through Jesus Christ to come to the throne of God. And I should come boldly because of the Father, or because of the Son, my relationship there. And so this morning I ask you, how is that relationship? Are you able to boldly go before the throne of God? Are you able to go in confidence and sit at His feet? Are you able to boldly go and sit at the feet of Jesus and eat at His table and enjoy the privilege because we know the Father? This morning, Paul was trying to share with them that yes, you can do anything because you have access to the Father. So why don't you come boldly before Him? This morning we have been given access, and that access gives us boldness. Secondly, this morning is you have been given access, and that access grants you the riches of His glory. The riches of His glory. Again, I ask the question, repeating, are you going boldly to the throne? Do we realize the access that we have? I don't know about you. I can only speak for myself. But I know many times, there's been a lot of time in my life that I have not truly understood the access that I have. I've not truly comprehended just the reality that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that I have access to Him. I have access to Him. And so as we keep moving on this morning, I think when we realize that, we realize that we can go with boldness, we can go with confidence, but then we understand that it's that boldness, it's that confidence because of Him, that we now have the riches of His glory that are at our fingertips. See, in verses 14 through 16, we see this. It says, for this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord. For this cause, if you were to go to the very first verse of chapter 3, it would say the same thing. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus. What is that cause? If you were to go back to chapter number 2, you would see in chapter 2, it says that we are His workmanship. No longer strangers and aliens, but fellow citizens with the saints of God's household. So Paul was speaking of what they had, the things that were at their fingertips because of their relationship with Jesus Christ, of who we are in Christ Jesus. We are His workmanship. I'm not a stranger to God. I'm not an alien, but I am a fellow citizen. I am an heir of the throne of God. See, for this reason, I come and I pray before the Lord. This is Paul's kind of saying this. He's saying, God, I come, or maybe he's speaking to the Ephesians. He says, listen, because of this, because of who we are in Him, because I'm no longer an alien, because I am His workman, because of those things, I'm coming before God on your behalf. That you would understand this identity. That you would grasp a hold of the revelation that's been given to you. So Ephesians, I pray that you would use this power, that you would realize the access that's been given, that you would come before Him with boldness, that you would have confidence, that you know that I'm praying that God gives you and that God grants you these riches according to His glory. This is Paul's prayer to God on behalf of the Ephesians. Oh God, I pray that they would grasp it. Oh God, I pray that they would understand. And he says what? that they would be granted the riches according to his glory. What are the riches according to God's glory? What is that? Man, maybe right now you would stop and maybe you write that down. Maybe you go back in a little bit later and you would just jot down the riches of God's glory. I don't have the time to go through everything, but Paul prayed that they would be strengthened with power through his spirit in the inner man. Paul says, oh, I pray that the Ephesians, I pray that you would grasp that this isn't from me, but this is truly from God, that he is desiring to use you, that he would come inside of you from the inner man and change it, that it would pour out of you. That you would grasp a hold of this. He prayed that they would experience a spiritual wealth from God. Not just in knowledge, not just in education, but they would get this spiritual wealth from God. So again, what are those spiritual riches according to his glory? I'm just going to give you a couple of them. Truly, the spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Maybe it's his redemption and it's his forgiveness. Maybe it's his making known the mystery of his will and his word to you. It's grasping that as I dive into the word of God, that God gives me the wisdom, God gives me the understanding, that as I open his word, he begins to speak to me and the light bulb goes off and it's, oh, I got it. The mysteries are being given to us. Maybe it's the understanding and the inheritance of his son. The riches are the truths of God's word, his wisdom, his kindness, his mercy, his love, his glory, his supplication of all things that we need and desire. Maybe it's understanding that he has given you an assurance of your salvation. He has given you an assurance. He has given you a hope. He has given you a peace and a joy that passes all understanding. These are just a little glimpse of some of the riches that God desires that we would have. Why? Because we have been given access to the Father. Paul prays, God, would you grant them this? Would you grant them these riches? I pray that you'd be granted this, but I pray that we would all understand. We have access to go to him and plead and know these riches because we go to the Father. Why do we have them? Because we can go to him. And the more that I am growing in my faith, the more that I confidently and comfortably go before the throne room of God, the more that the riches begin to fill up inside of me and begin, it says, that inner man, and begin to pour out of who I am. And it shows on my face and my countenance. It shows in what I say and it shows in how I act. It's the riches in him that gives us and enables us to live a life with strength through his spirit. Paul prayed for their spiritual health to be strengthened, which would pour out into everything that they do. There is no way around it, physically speaking. If I want to get stronger and if I want to do certain things to make my body physically be this or be that, there's work that has to come. There's something that I have to pour into it. I can't just say, oh, I want this, and next day it's there. No, there's a lot of work and time. It's the same thing spiritually speaking. It's time. It's waking up. It's reading the word of God. It's God pouring into us the mysteries. It's God giving to us what we are seeking in him. And the mystery being revealed and you coming to a place like Paul did, where it's us running to him. The riches of God's glory are for you. See, regardless of my past, I can still have the riches. See, Saul was a wicked, wicked man. But it wasn't about any of that. It was about God reaching down and saying, I've got a plan for you. And it's God reaching down to your life and my life and saying, I've got a plan for you. I've got a plan for you. Would we tap into that and experience the spiritual richness that is in God. Experience that grace of God. It's as we discipline our minds, it's as we study God's word, that we begin to live that out. We are nourished and we're strengthened. It pours out of us. This passage continues to happen and continues to speak about faith, and it continues on that inner man. And what does God's word say? It says that we begin to have a greater, that we would have a love. Jesus said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you would love one another as I have loved you." This passage speaks of that love would dwell inside of us, that we would be rooted and grounded in love. And that happens as we know Him and we experience the riches of God's glory that happens from Him. And then it pours out into every other area of our lives. Listen, this morning, you have been given access, and that access has given you boldness. That access grants you the riches of His glory. And lastly, this morning, you have been given access, and that access fills us with the fullness of God. See, the more and the more that we grow, the more that we live a life being filled with God, the more God continues to unveil His mysteries, the more confidently and boldly I'm able to go before His throne, because my faith is growing. The Word of God says that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And so the more that I'm growing in my faith, the more that I'm growing in the Word, the more that my faith grows. Why? Because I'm seeing it, I'm watching it, and I'm feeling it inside as it's unveiling to me. The mysteries are, I'm being able to see this, and I understand that more, and my wisdom is growing. Why? Because I'm seeking that from God. And as I do that, I realize, wow, I have access. I'm living bold in my life. I'm experiencing the riches that God has planned for me to experience. And I'm walking. I have a fullness about me that I've never had before. The more we experience the riches and wealth of the Lord, the more I realize in my life, yes, I can. Yes, I can, because He did. I can state this caveat: no, I cannot do anything. The Word of God says, apart from me, you can do nothing, Jesus says in John. But when I realize who He is, what I am, I can go boldly to Him because of my walk. Because why? He died, He rose again. And as I said yes to Him, He came to live inside of me. And out of that, it pours out of me. And yeah, I can walk in boldness, and I can do the things that God has called for me to do. This inner feeling is incomprehensible. I cannot explain it no more than you could. It's something that's incredible. It's indescribable. We have recently spoken Galatians. If you were with us for any of that, we talked about being filled with the Spirit in Galatians, that we would live and act accordingly. Here, it's very similar, and it's this. It's that we would live a life of total domination in our lives by God. That I would literally say, God, I am going to empty all of me so that you can fill me. That it's not about me. It's not about if I get glory. It's not about if I do this. It's not about any of those things. God, whatever you would have, I am going to empty all of me. And God, I want you to fill me. That you would fill me, and that you would rule and reign in my life. See, it's in that filling that the greatest questions are asked on such a regular basis of how can I have hope? How can I have purpose? How can I have peace and joy? It's because all of those things don't come from anything but Him. True joy and true peace and true comfort comes from Him, not from anything that we can do. We can live that hope because it's not us, but it's Him filling us and in and through us. See, if we stop and think of this, that God loves us so much that he won't stop until we are completely like him. God's main emphasis is that all that would know, that all would come to know him, and that we would be like him. How is God molding me to be more like him? In this time, in this season that we're in of things being shut down and having to be at home and being out of our comfort zones and doing those things, God is molding and making us to be more like his son so that we can be drawn back to him. Maybe it's a different situation for your life. There's been other things that have happened that God is just saying, hey, I'm just reminding you that I'm right here. I want to remind you. I want to show you that I love you. I want to reveal to you that I love you. Why? Because I won't stop in making you like my son. In Psalms chapter 17 and verse 15, David said it this way: as for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. David wasn't going to be satisfied until he was awake in his likeness, in God's likeness. He wasn't comfortable. See, Paul says in his prayer, to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond all we ask or think, to him be glory. I'd say this today, and really this sermon is not so much about that we can do exceeding and abundantly beyond all that we ask or think. That is a byproduct of having access to God. That is a byproduct of knowing God. That is a byproduct of living a life of joy and peace, that we have that opportunity, because all of that, the exceeding abundant, that is not about all the things that we have, but that is God filling us from the inside, and that we live with joy and peace, and it's above and beyond anything that we could ever think. So I would say to you today, as a believer, you have access to the King of Kings. You have been given direct contact with him. We can thus go confidently and boldly before his throne. You know, that thought right there should enable us to just jump and shout and celebrate and worship. Because I have been given access to him, and I can go boldly to his throne. I don't have to question if I can go to him. I can confidently go boldly to the throne of God, is what God's word says. And in that, we understand that we have been granted according to his riches and glory. You know, we realize all of these things when we're diving in and pouring out to him, that he fills us. See, because it's when I'm walking in the fullness of God that I realize what is at my fingertips. I realize the grace of God in my life, that I don't deserve anything. I realize that I can bow my head, that I can shout out from my car, that I can cry and weep in my pillow. I realize that I can celebrate the goodness of God and the good and the bad. I can do all of these things because why? I have been given access to him, and it's in and through him that I have joy and I have peace, and I can walk and live with boldness, and that I have the joy of knowing that I, according to his riches. It's all of those things that allow me to realize God is doing more, exceeding abundantly beyond anything that I could ever think or imagine. And that's so powerful. And I pray today, believer, I pray that you grasp a hold of the access that you have to God. And maybe today you sit there and you're listening to this. Maybe you're in your car. Maybe you're sitting right now on a couch. And you might say, I desire to have this access. I desire to know God. I desire to be able to boldly go before the throne of God. I desire this, but I don't understand and I don't know how. And I would plead with you to say this, that God desired that you would know him. He desired so much that he sent his son to die upon a cross for your sin, for the wrongdoing that we do. God sent his son Jesus to die, carrying all of that sin to that cross. He didn't just die upon a cross. But 3 days later, it says that he rose again. And he did that because he wanted to make a way for you to be in relationship with him. This morning, maybe you would say, I don't have access to him. I don't understand that. Can I just plead with you today from wherever you are? Would you just cry out to God and say, God, I know that I accept the sin of my life. I know that I have failed in that way. God, I believe that you have sent your son on my behalf. God, I want to pour out and say how sorry I am for my sin. Would you forgive me and cleanse me? And make me new. Believer today, let me ask you, is there something between you and God that is keeping you from going boldly before God? Is there something that's keeping you from boldly going to the throne of God this morning? If there is, maybe today is a day of just confession, that we would confess our sin. He says if we would confess, he is faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness. Would we confess our sin and run to the Father, that we would enjoy access, that we would enjoy fellowship together the way that it was intended to be. This morning, yes, you can. Because you have been given access. Father, I come to you. And God, I pray that wherever anybody hears this today, that God, they would not listen to the lies of the enemy. The lies that he is trying to tell them that they're not good enough, they're not pretty enough, they don't have a nice enough voice, and they can't do this and they can't do that. And oh, don't forget all of the things that you've done in your life. Therefore, God could never use you. God would never love you. Would you help them right now to realize that that is a lie? And God, that you love them, that you gave your son for them, that they can know you. And for those that sit, that know you as Savior, God, would you draw them to yourself? Would you convict them where they need to be convicted? God, would they cry out to you as Lord and Savior? Would they come back to you? Would they realize the access that they have, and because of that, the riches that you are pouring out upon them, and that they can live a life that is full and exceeding and abundantly above what they could think or they could ask. Father, I pray that you spoke to lives today, for it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Again, thank you so much for joining with us today from wherever it is that you joined with us from. If you have made a decision, if I could encourage you in two different things. One of them is this: if you would so, there's a Connect card that is a digital card that you can fill out right there on your computer or your phone, and it would come to our office. But we would love to be able to communicate and connect with you if you have made a decision, especially if you made a decision to follow Christ as Savior. Or you could do this: you could text the word decision to the text message to the phone that is the phone number, there we go, that is right below. And if you would do that, we would love to connect with you. Again, one of our staff would love to reach out to you and help you through the decision that you have made. Thank you so much for joining us, and have an amazing day.
We just want to thank you again for joining us today. We pray that the service has been an encouragement and a blessing to you. Oasis is supported by the gifts of faithful people like you. So if you have a desire to give to the ministry and mission of Oasis, you can text GIVE to the number provided below. Click on the GIVE link and mail in your gift to the church office. We also have a desire to pray for you. So if you have a prayer request, please email us at prayer@oasislv.church. Church, we have been encouraged to live a life of power because of the access that we have been given. So let's be passionate followers of Christ.